Thank you. You may be seated.
So before we get started, we wanted to share with you some of the very specific instructions that Dad left for this service. If you know Dad at all, it won't surprise you to know that he planned his funeral, wrote his obituary, and gave us all these notes. And again, we wanted to share those with you. Dale C. Morrison, funeral service, specific instructions. I hope it is possible to attend my funeral service, as did President Wilford Woodruff, who wrote in his last will and testament, "If the laws and customs of the spirit world will permit, I should wish to attend my funeral myself." He goes on to say, "My funeral is to be seen as an official church meeting and is to be conducted under the bishop's presiding authority. My family should not expect the bishop to turn the service over to them, and the family is to seek his approval for the specific instructions which follow, and happily acquiesce to his counsel. All will benefit from a careful reading of funerals and other services at the time of death. With the exception of one, he believes that all of these specific instructions listed all fall within the parameters of official church policy."
Number one, if possible and practical, the funeral service is to be held on a Saturday, so that the inconvenience to those who may wish to attend will be minimal. The funeral is to start precisely on time, which means that the pre-funeral viewing or visitation is to end 30 minutes prior to the announced time for the funeral, so that there will be ample time for the family prayer and moving into the chapel. Depending on location, there may or may not be much of a line. Delays must not occur, and punctuality must be vigorously observed.
I do not want an overly expensive casket or flowers, since bubble wrap and cardboard are probably illegal. A basic and respectable casket will serve all necessary purposes. While left to family discretion, cremation is not to be considered, since, in my view, those who so submit make a real ash of themselves. Money otherwise spent on flowers or other adornments should be donated to the Humanitarian Aid Fund. A little granddaughter's dandelion from the front lawn is all that's needed.
I do not want the casket open during what is called the viewing or visitation, either at the mortuary or the chapel prior to the service. I refuse to be the subject of expressions such as, "He looks so peaceful," or "Didn't they do a nice job on him?" Please, at that point in the eternal pilgrimage, one looks as bad as he ever will, and no amount of powder and perfume will improve the grievous state of affairs. Everyone should remember, however, these lines found on a Massachusetts gravestone. "Under the sod and under the trees lies the body of Jonathan Pease. He is not here. There's only the pod. Pease shelled out and went to God."
Number four, since funerals are a wonderful teaching moment, the main focus of the service is to be on the doctrines of the Restoration, including the atonement and resurrection of the Savior, and the certainty of life after death, and the continuity of the family. There is far more interest in such doctrines than in quote-unquote memories, in which there is far less interest except among family members. A brief eulogy giving an overview of my life is appropriate. President Boyd K. Packer offered the following counsel, to which I enthusiastically subscribe. Funerals could and should be the most spiritually impressive. They are becoming informal family reunions in front of the ward members. When the family insists that several family members speak at a funeral, we hear about the deceased instead about the atonement, the resurrection, and the comforting promises revealed in the scripture. Now, it's all right to have a family member speak at a funeral, but if they do, their remarks should be in keeping with the spirit of the meeting.
Prayers are not to be sermonettes or homilies and are characterized by the invocation of God's Holy Spirit on the business at hand as well as on brevity. Public prayers should be short and ordinarily should contain no expressions except those which pertain to the needs and circumstances surrounding the particular meeting involved. They are not sermons or occasions to disclose the oratorical or linguistic abilities of the one acting as the mouth. It is necessary to offer a long and tedious prayer, or it is not necessary to offer a long and tedious prayer, either at the opening or closing. 2 minutes will open any kind of meeting, and a half a minute will close it. The family prayer and dedication of the grave are not necessarily under these specific guidelines and should be characterized by the focus of the task at hand.
Number 4, my favorite. The service is not to exceed more than 1 hour. The accompanying pre-planned program is designed to eliminate the need or tendency to add speakers or other components to the service. Through it all, the comfort and convenience of those who may choose to attend is to be aggressively facilitated. You comfortable, Allie? Yeah. Sister Head, you good? Okay. I hope that the spirit of reverence would characterize the service. Such a spirit will be fostered if the remarks and prayers are appropriate and the prelude and postlude music is familiar.
Thanks for coming out. Have a break.
Good afternoon, brothers and sisters, family and friends. Since the funeral was scheduled to start at 1:30 and it's 1:29, I think we're doing pretty well. My name is Rob Holmes, and I'll be conducting and presiding at this meeting today as we honor the life of Dale Clark Moritzen. I currently serve in the bishopric of Dale and Marta's ward in Gig Harbor, Washington, where they have lived for the past 2 years. This is a tender time for the Moritzen family. And on behalf of the family, we thank you for loving Dale and their family and celebrating his life and his legacy with us today. Prior to the procession, a beautiful family prayer was offered by Matthew C. Moritzen, Dale's oldest son. We're grateful for Raylene Guthrie and Jocelyn Orgel for providing our music today. And we'll open this meeting by singing Jesus, Lover of My Soul, hymn number 102. Following the opening hymn, our invocation will be offered by Dale's sister, Leela Scholes.
Thank you.
I'm a little bit nervous. I hope that Dale will approve. Our dear Father in heaven, we are so very thankful to have gathered safely here this day in such nice circumstances, peaceful setting. And we are grateful for the technology thou hast blessed us with that has enabled others to be able to be with us this day. As we come together to commemorate and remember with love and appreciation one of thy beloved sons, Dale Clark Moritzen. Remember his life of service, his love of family, his good humor, his gospel knowledge, and his great talent in teaching. Blessed we feel to, as close friends and family, to have had the privilege to associate with him in our mortal life. And we express deep gratitude to thee for thy beautiful plan of happiness, which gives us the hope and the assurance that we can all be together again, with none missing, which was Dale's always his hope and prayer. We pray for thy spirit to be with us this day, in this meeting, and in all the proceedings of this day. We pray that we will be uplifted and taught and strengthened. We pray that thy spirit will fill our hearts and bring peace to our souls, as only thou art able. To his wonderful family, Marta, their children and grandchildren, and to all of us as well. We humbly ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. I know Dale's children have tried to follow the outline he left behind as closely as possible, and so we'll proceed with the meeting as follows. A musical number, Precious Memories, will be performed by Colleen Brunson and accompanied by Julie Webb Burgess. Following them, Maren Moritzen, Dale's oldest daughter, will then share his biography. The Moritzen grandchildren will then sing I Am a Child of God, and this will be followed by a few remarks from Dale's youngest daughter and my favorite, Melissa. Following Melissa, we'll hear a musical number from a few of Dale's nephews, Brent Carl and Scott Moritzen, who will sing Come Lay His Books and Papers By, which is accompanied by Shannon Moritzen. And then we will conclude the meeting with remarks by President Philip J. Carmack. We'll go to that point in the program.
Memories, how they linger.
In our Come Follow Me study this week, we learned in Deuteronomy that we need to beware lest thou forget the Lord. We need to remember. Our favorite missionary shared in her weekly email an aha moment she received as she was pondering the importance of remembering. In Jacob 6:4, she read, "How merciful is our God unto us, for he remembereth us." We remember because we love. Love is remembering. We are so thankful to each of you who have shown your love for our Father and are gathered here today to help us remember him. In your program is the full biography that our Father wrote. He asked me to share a few highlights today. Del Clark Moritzen was born in Murray, Utah on July 11, 1942. He was the oldest of seven boys and three girls. He was raised in Draper, Granger, and later on a dairy farm in Lewiston, Utah. Apparently, there were many cows. And there has been a lot of talk about who milked the most. But knowing what a hard worker our dad was, we think it was him. Dad was active in the Boy Scouts of America and achieved the rank of Eagle Scout. In 1960, he graduated from North Cache High School and Richmond Seminary, and he always kept in touch and had fond memories of his friends there. After that, he was employed for two summers working on the railroad. When you sing, "I've been working on the railroad all the livelong day," you can think of Grandpa. Dad served a mission for the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints in the Eastern Atlantic States Mission. On his mission, Dad developed a deep love for the Lord and for missionary work. As an avid lover of American history, he also enjoyed living in a part of the country that was close to many historical sites. He attended Brigham Young University and completed a BS in American history, a master's in Mormon history and doctrine, and a PhD in American history. In 1964, Dale met Marta Christensen in their BYU ward. They were married in the Los Angeles Temple on January 27, 1965. They have seven children. Would each of those seven children please stand up? Would each of the spouses of those seven children please stand up? Would each of Dell and Marta's grandchildren please stand up? Would each of his brothers and sisters please stand up? Would each of those brothers and sisters that married into his family or that he married into, please stand up? Would all of his nieces and nephews and grandnieces and nephews and those who married into this family, please stand up? If you ever learned a lesson from Dale Moritzen, will you please stand up? Brothers and sisters, we are Dale Clark Moritzen's legacy. You may sit down. Dale and Marta lived in Provo and Orem, Utah for the first few years of their marriage. Then in 1971, they moved to Sunnyvale, California. In 2020, they moved to Gig Harbor, Washington, because as my dad told everyone, it was only because the stairs finally won. In 1966, Dad was employed by the church educational system of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints as a teacher and administrator. He taught seminary in Lehi and Orem, an institute at Stanford University, San Jose State University, and De Anza and West Valley Community Colleges. He was a popular writer and lecturer, and he retired in 2011. Even after he stopped receiving a paycheck, Dad continued teaching a weekly religion class. He loved helping others learn more about Jesus Christ. He was always willing to share his knowledge through a manila envelope or an email or a discussion on the front porch. Dad loved living in Sunnyvale, California, and called it the Valley of the Heart's Delight, and compared the weather to what it would be in the celestial kingdom. He showed his love by volunteering at the Sunnyvale Heritage Park Museum. During this time, he also served as the Heritage Commissioner for the City of Sunnyvale. He was so thankful for all the new friends he made during this service. Dad was always reading Westerns, poetry, English history, any type of American history, any type of church history and doctrine. He enjoyed collecting early 20th century American novels, and he loved playing basketball. If this service had been held 10 years earlier than this, his pallbearers would have been his basketball friends. He loved his basketball cronies, and he loved all kinds of music, especially traditional country music. As an active member of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, Dad held many different callings. He especially enjoyed serving as Bishop of the Lawrence Station Ward and First Counselor in the Presidency of the Los Altos, California Stake. When my parents moved to Washington, it was my task to help put my dad's office back together. We all wanted him to feel at home in his new house. He would sit in a chair as I pulled out hundreds of books and binders from the moving boxes and organized thousands of files. Dad had comments about many of these items that he would share with me. It was a very sacred time. There were many old books, a lot of history books, but there were literally hundreds of books about church doctrine, the gospel of Jesus Christ, and the lives of the Latter-day prophets. Binders and binders full of his lectures. Dad devoted his entire life to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we are so excited that after all his earthly labors, he is at peace, and that knowledge has replaced his faith. He had a deep and enduring testimony of the plan of salvation. And because of our dad, so do we. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
With parents kind and
I've been fortunate to have my parents live just around the corner from our family for the last few years, and while I know Dad missed Sunnyvale every single day, I am so very grateful for the time that we had together and that my children were able to know their grandpa. Many have asked how I got to be so lucky when they decided to move to Gig Harbor. I must be the favorite, I'd reply, to which I might add, Dad never corrected me or said any different. But if I was indeed his favorite, it's only because I have two big brothers and four big sisters who've inspired me to try and become as much like them as possible, because they are the very best people I know. And I like to think Dad saw little of each of them in me, which explains why I was potentially the favorite. In the weeks leading up to my dad's passing, he wasn't able to speak very much. And so during the hours we spent alone in his hospital room, I would turn on his favorite music to fill the quiet and help pass the time. And even during the moments when he was in the most pain, those familiar sounds seemed to calm his soul and offered an added measure of peace to both of us. Each song brought memories to my mind, and I'm sure they did to Dad's also. One of his favorite country hymns that our friend Colleen so beautifully sang today outlines exactly what I know my dad was thinking during his final days. Precious memories, unseen angels, sent from somewhere to my soul, how they linger ever near me and the sacred past unfold. And so, brothers and sisters, we do have precious memories, and even though my older siblings and I have some different memories, because that's what happens when there's seven children in a family, Dad is somehow part of all of these. Some are sad, but most are happy. We remember stories of Lewiston and Dad's black and white pinto mare that he found tied to the fence one Christmas morning, and how he named her Flicka and rode her everywhere he went, and how he likened Flicka's colt having to be put down to one of the greatest lessons in his young life of how the atonement of Jesus Christ works in our lives. We remember Dad laughing at the dinner table as he told stories of his boyhood shenanigans, visiting Hall's store, riding all the way to Smithfield and Burke and Evan, and working on the railroad. We remember family road trips to Utah every summer to visit Grandma and Grandpa Mortson, and waking up before the sun to get an early start and asking, are we there yet, before even getting on Lawrence Expressway. And stopping at the A&W in Winnemucca and knowing that we were almost there once we hit Grantsville, and then even closer when we saw the Indian on the side of the road waving at us. We remember Saturday mornings waking up to Dad playing loud country music, loud enough to drown out Mr. Shum's opera, Emmylou Harris and Loretta Lynn and George Jones. We remember Dad gathering all the neighborhood kids on Sprigg Court and treating everyone to Star Wars at the movie theater. We remember the Pinto and the RX-7 and the Mustang, and the way he'd speed through residential streets all around Sunnyvale just to avoid stopping at a red light. We remember our early morning paper route and sitting in the back of the Pinto with our feet hanging out while Dad would drive up Teal and down Thunderbird, and we'd hop out and run papers up to the doorstep, and how the very best mornings were when Dad would let us sleep in and do the whole route himself. We remember waking up early for morning seminary and Dad making us breakfast and knowing if we weren't in the driveway ready to go at 5:46, he'd leave us behind because he was not going to be late for basketball. We remember KRTY and Julie Stevens, and there's country music and there's Western music, but there's no such thing as country Western music. And Tanya Tucker singing to Marin on the radio when she left on her mission to Corpus Christi. We remember enchiladas at Acapulco and the smell of fresh air-popped popcorn with probably a little too much butter and definitely a little too much salt. We remember summers living in the dorms at BYU while Dad finished his PhD and cheering for the Cougars during countless ball games. We remember Dad offering to babysit the grandkids and assuring us he was fine and prepared and ready, but then asking as we were walking out the door, now, what exactly am I supposed to do? We remember our friends spending half their lives being scared of Dad and half their lives loving him. We remember a motorhome trip across the country with seven kids in tow, watching Seven Brides for Seven Brothers and the unsinkable Molly Brown, and at each stop along the way, Dad gathering us all around and presenting a lesson about why this location was significant before we could get out of the motorhome. We remember him taking us to see Queen Elizabeth and the Olympic torch and the Blue Angels. We remember Dad traveling long distances to be at our children's baby blessings and baptisms.
and Jocelyn's wedding and how much it meant to us to have him there. We remember him sitting on the stand as bishop of the Lawrence Station Ward and the painting he commissioned from Sister Parent and long talks on the front porch and him calling us up to his bedroom to kneel around the bed for family prayer. We remember him holding each of our babies and loving them and him getting down on his hands and knees to play Tickle Monster. We remember Stan's donuts and donut wheel and Dad playing the boogie-woogie on the piano while we danced around the living room. We remember the candy fairy and Good and Plenty's and Dad never wanting us kids to not have something he knew we wanted. We remember Christmas Eves caroling to the Nakamotos and the Enrights and the Sariarvis and Christmas mornings with Dad filling up big black trash sacks with wrapping paper from our gifts. We remember letters Dad mailed to us at girls' camp and on missions and while we were away at college or living overseas, especially loving the handwritten ones, and how he always included an update on the weather and a few dollar bills just when we needed it most. We remember gifts out of the blue just because he thought we might like it and giving us permission to get our ears pierced even though he knew Mom would be mad. We remember when licorice bit the mailman and Dad went to the pound to get him back, but it was too late. We remember the earthquake of 89 and Dad running out to the backyard to find Daylene under the trampoline, soaking wet from the Coosa's pool water, and being together as a family in the brand new Philadelphia Temple prior to its opening house. We remember the time he took us horseback riding in Saratoga and Dad saying things like, "You're cruising for a bruising," or "We're going to miss you," or "Would you like to become a pedestrian?" We remember the building on Stelling and the peaceful feeling of being at Dad's office and calling the Institute at 253-3140 and saying, "Hi, Sister Reader," or "Hi, Penny, this is Melissa. Is my dad available?" We remember Mom and Dad going to the Oakland Temple for the day and always coming back in a better mood. We remember Dad being released from the stake presidency and his final talk, his last lecture, he called it. That might have been a little longer than what was asked for, but he couldn't pass up the opportunity to teach doctrine from the pulpit in the Los Altos stake one last time. We remember Shakey's Pizza and crossing our fingers that he'd share a piece or two, and the time he fibbed about Daylene's age to get her on a flight for free, and the time he left Matthew somewhere in the middle of Ohio on our trip back east. We remember the somber feeling we all felt when Dad told us about Aunt Maureen in the plane crash. We remember Father's blessings and family reunions in Philadelphia and San Luis Obispo and Sequoia National Park, and Dad making the trip, even though traveling was not his favorite thing to do, but knowing that he would come if we asked. We remember pineapple malt and Grandpa jumping in the pool with all of his clothes on and concerts to see Emmylou Harris and Dwight Yoakam and Carlene Carter. We remember his old wine jug for coins and his top drawer with cups full of quarters and snuggling a Mom and Dad's bed to watch The Wonderful World of Disney or old Western movies. And damn and hell aren't swear words because John Wayne said them. We remember asking him for money because we knew Mom would say no. And the only thing we ever knew to give Dad for Christmas were new combs because he didn't want us ever spending our money on him. And sneaking into his bedroom at night with a blanket over our head because we thought he couldn't see us. And then falling asleep on his bedroom floor while he watched TV. And how he'd brag about his grandchildren and all their achievements to whoever would listen. We remember him taking Mark driving over at Peterson and mistaking the gas for the brake and having to throw his leg over the middle console to stop the car from crashing, and that was the last time Dad took Mark driving. We remember running upstairs to tell Dad we were ready to leave for school and stopping in our tracks to find him kneeling by the side of his bed praying and feeling a comfort knowing that he was likely praying for us. We remember coming to Dad for advice about school and boys and friends and current events and assignments and important decisions, and him always instilling a confidence in us that we would do the right thing and make the right decision. We remember Dad supporting Mom in all her pursuits, years of girls' camp and teaching preschool and stamping at the Dixon's cabin and trips with her sisters to grandmother's house. We remember going home teaching with Dad to Sister Zarati and so many others, and what a kick he would get out of hearing a good joke or a story, especially those told by Uncle Dick. We remember how proud he was of Matthew and Mark for serving their mission together, and knowing that was something only an older brother could do.
We remember helping Mom and Dad pack up their home of nearly 50 years in Sunnyvale, and the parade of good friends who came to say goodbye, and Dad being so pleased that he had the chance to see those beloved faces one last time before moving away. More recently, we remember a special day at the happiest place on earth and being all together as siblings to celebrate Mark's birthday and telling my dad about how pleasant and happy Mark was and how it had been the best day of his life. And even though Dad couldn't speak, tears rolled down his cheeks, and that told us that he was so pleased and so proud of his children. We remember Dad's office full of history books and church books and atlases and his files and binders and saying, this is his life's work. But then reading letter after letter, expressing how Dad had taught them and encouraged them, and realizing only then that his life's work wasn't the files and the books and the lectures. Rather, his life's work was were the people who he taught and loved and changed. We will remember these and 1,000 other memories forever. Yes, indeed, precious memories, how they linger, how they ever flood my soul. In the stillness of the midnight, precious sacred scenes unfold. Most importantly, we remember the example that Dad set for each of us to know the gospel and to follow the prophet and to be good boys and girls so that we can all gather in celestial settings with none missing. May we do so in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
The teacher's work was done.
Good afternoon, family, friends, sisters, brothers, loved ones. It's an amazing privilege to be able to speak about the gospel at Dale's memorial service. I know he would have patience and love for me, grace for my weakness in trying to preach the gospel, following such a man like him. He was one of the great. He was in constant search of increased knowledge, and he was a master teacher. About 33 years ago, our family suffered a tragic and devastating loss when my 3-year-old nephew, Jaden, drowned in a backyard pool. We were all heartbroken, and many were struggling to find peace and hope after this loss. It was at this time that I first experienced a packet from Dale Morrison. The packet outlined Jaden's state in the spirit world and clearly documented that he had a direct path to the celestial kingdom as a young child. What a feeling of peace accompanied that knowledge taught in such clarity for us. The power of the gospel is a power of motivation. During the 12 years that I served with Dale closely, a few years as counselor to him when he was bishop, 9.5 years with him as my counselor as I was stake president, he had a profound influence on my knowledge of the gospel and my confidence in God's plan. I would even go so far as to say that there is no other person that's influenced my knowledge of the gospel more than Dale Morrison. And so I'm grateful to be able to talk about the plan of salvation. It's also known as the great plan of God, or my personal favorite, the plan of happiness. And it consists of 4 major stages. There's the pre-existence before we came here. There's mortal life here on earth, what Dale just completed. There's death and the spirit world, followed by 4th, the resurrection, the final judgment, and the obtaining of our kingdom of heaven. Let me just spend a little time going through those. 1, the pre-existence. The book of Hebrews, along with other prophetic teachings like the family proclamation, teach us that we are spirit children, literally, of heavenly parents, and that we were with God in the pre-existence. In the pre-existence, God put forth a plan that would allow us to progress to be more like him, obtain eternal bodies, and live with him forever in his presence, in happiness in the celestial kingdom. But we had to use our agency to make our own choices and take on imperfect bodies and be tested and learn faith. Satan tried to present an alternate plan that would force us to heaven by taking away our agency. Moses chapter 4 says, "Satan rebelled against me and sought to destroy the agency of man, which I, the Lord, had given him, and also that I should give unto him mine own power." Fortunately for us, we accepted God's plan, while 1/3 of our spirit siblings rejected the plan and were cast out with Satan. 2, our mortal lives. Having established the plan, earth was created. A fall was required in order for us to test our faith and experience trials on earth. Eve and Adam established the fall through their choice, which introduced death into the world, which is the separation of the spirit from our bodies. And spiritual death was also introduced, which is the separation of us from the presence of God. A veil is placed between us and our memory of the pre-existence. The Savior's atonement allows us to overcome both spiritual and physical death through resurrection and repentance. Regarding the veil and the role of our earthly experiences, Elder Bruce C. Hafen said in July 1977, "It is a fact of nature that salvation is a process as well as a goal. Salvation involves growth, development, and change. That process implies that in mortality, we must learn capacities and skills, not merely pick up information, end quote. The process of becoming saved includes what we learn from our suffering. It includes the things that we have to experience by being here on the earth, in imperfect bodies, in an imperfect world. Even the Savior learned from suffering. In Hebrews, the Apostle Paul wrote, "Though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered." And Christ himself, in his own words, said in Doctrine and Covenants, section 19, "Which suffering caused myself, even God, the greatest of all, to tremble because of pain, and to bleed at every pore, and to suffer both body and spirit, and would that I might not drink the bitter cup and shrink." Even Christ had natural reactions to the pain of suffering and learned from it. And of course, he did complete his task, and he atoned for us. And our own that makes it possible that our own suffering can cause us to grow and learn and become. 3, death and the spirit world. Death is also part of the process in this plan. The Book of Alma teaches us that our next step after death is the spirit world. There we enter a state of peace and happiness if we chose to obey God in this life, or we enter a state of unhappiness if we did not repent and obey. As a matter of fact, Dale wrote an article on the subject of the afterlife in the January 1977 edition of The Ensign. And I'm quoting just a small part of that document. "As I've listened to and participated in conversations on after death, what?" Sounds like the way Dale would say it. After death, what? "With students and family in various areas in the church, I've nearly always found two feelings expressed: a great desire to know about the post-earthly spirit world, and an apologetic feeling for having questions, as though the spirit world were a subject that we should not discuss. The desire to know is in itself a good one. It is a healthy, holy subject, and should be discussed in that tone," end quote. He then went on to talk about that the prophet Joseph told us that if we have any claim on our Heavenly Father, it is to get answers to the questions about our eternal existence. And we know from Peter in the New Testament, chapters 3 and 4, various excerpts, that that Christ taught in the spirit world after his death and before his resurrection. So gospel preaching continues in the spirit world, and we can continue to progress. I'm sure Dale has already been put to good work teaching there. And he wanted to attend here, but he might be busy. I don't know. I wouldn't be surprised. And 4, the resurrection and judgment. All of us are resurrected thanks to the Savior's sacrifice. Meanwhile, the judgment will determine if we receive exaltation in the celestial kingdom. From Doctrine and Covenants, section 76, we understand that the celestial kingdom is the highest kingdom of glory, and is equated to being in the presence of God and being with our families if we are eternally bound. The terrestrial and telestial kingdoms are the lesser degrees of glory. I won't spend a lot of time on that today, but there's a lot to learn about the entire three kingdoms of glory. God's goal is for all of us to achieve eternal life in the celestial kingdom. "For behold, this is my work and my glory, to bring to pass the immortality and eternal life of man." That's found in Moses chapter 1, verse 39. What an amazing expression of our Heavenly Father's love for us. The plan that I've just discussed briefly, it's not easy up here. That's what Dale would say. You think it's easy up here? Sat with him so many times up there. I know it's for me. The plan is what motivates us to get through the difficult challenges in our lives on our way back to our heavenly parents. In Alma chapter 12, it says, "God gave unto them commandments after having made known unto them the plan of redemption. I don't think it's any accident that the commandments came after the plan. God gave unto them commandments after having made known unto them the plan of redemption. Think about it. We just went through it. We are offspring of deity. Every single person in this room, every single person who's been to the earth, we are offspring of deity. We're seed of God. We have a God-given right of agency, the ability to choose. What could stop us? We have the atonement to allow us to get through our imperfections and take on perfection, perfected bodies, and be in the presence of a perfected being. What's left to get in our way? Us is what's left. And the motivation, the knowledge, like the knowledge Dale shared with my family about Jaden's step, motivated us, made us want to do our best, get to see Jaden again, get to see each other again. There's nothing in our way, and that is why the plan, that's why I like to call it the plan of happiness, because it's basically the direction of what we need to do if we want to return to be with our Heavenly Father. And it helps get us through the sacrifices, the suffering, the challenges associated with obedience, the challenges associated with lack of obedience, or a feeling of inadequacy, or a feeling that we're not moving fast enough. God's plan, He plays the long game. I've seen it so much in my life, and so has Dale. The last conversation I had with Dale was a little over a month ago. I had no idea it would be our last conversation. We were speaking on the phone. He was laying in bed. I could hear in his voice the exquisite and unrelenting pain he was feeling in his back. He asked me, "What am I trying to learn from this? Can you explain to me what is pain trying to teach me right now?" We talked about it for a while, and then he taught me what it's there for, the suffering, and how it teaches us. And then he mustered up his strength, and the last thing he said to me as we were signing off, saying, "I hope we get to see you soon," he said, "I love you, Phil." And I said, "I love you, Dale." We both knew that whether sooner or later, there was to be happiness after this suffering he was going through, because we both knew the plan was true. The promise was real. At its core, God's plan of happiness is a plan of love. He has dedicated His work and His glory to our success and happiness. He gave His only begotten Son for us. I testify that God's plan of happiness is real, that the atonement can wash away all sorrow, pain, and imperfections. And if we have faith in Christ, follow His commandments, and endure to the end, we can be with Him and our heavenly parents again. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.
Thank you to all of those who have participated in our service today, and for all of you for worshiping here with us. I believe you have all made Dale proud. I met Dale almost 18 years ago after meeting a cute brown-eyed girl at BYU. And after we had been dating for some time, I thought I'd better meet her parents before asking Melissa to marry me, and I'm sure glad we did. Dale not only me the love of my life, but he welcomed me into a family of faithful people who I admire and love. I never saw Dale happier than when he was surrounded by his family, specifically observing his 19 grandchildren interact and play together, knowing his children and their spouses were happy and doing good things. Dale's been an encouragement to me in my professional goals. He's been a kind and loving grandfather to my children. He's modeled what a faithful husband and father should be. I have respected him both on the basketball court and in church meetings, and I've learned countless truths from him. It's been my honor to associate with Dale, to be a part of his family, and to play a small role today in honoring him. So I'd like to thank you all for being here. We will close by singing hymn number 217, "Come Let Us Anew." This will be followed by a benediction offered by Dale's brother, John Moritzen. After the benediction, I would ask that you please stand and allow the family to exit first. And we will then reconvene at the Spanish Fork City Cemetery for the dedication of the grave. Thank you.
Our dear Father in heaven, we're so grateful for the opportunity we've had to be in this sacred meeting to honor the life and celebrate the legacy of Dale Clark Moritzen, our dear husband and father and grandfather and brother. We're grateful for the gospel of Jesus Christ that Clark knew so well and taught so generously and lived so fully. We're grateful for the knowledge we have of the joyful reunions that have taken place with parents and siblings and other loved ones. We ask a special blessing, Father, on Marta and his children, Maren and Jennifer and Matthew and Mark, Laura, Daylene and Melissa and their families. We ask that they will give them a extra measure of comfort during this time. We pray as we travel today that we'll go safely. We pray that we will always remember the example of Clark, and we will always feel of his influence in our lives. And we say these things humbly in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Ask y'all to stand as the family exits and have the pallbearers come forward. Thank you, everyone.